net of value at Ripple, we're thinking much bigger than just cross-border payments. It's kind of like Amazon with rare books in the early days, just this market happens to be a $10 trillion market.
We are at a historic turning point.
Said in the past that you are doing for money what email did for communication.
Moving the whole revolution forward.
Think on it.
There's trillions of dollars parked around the world.
XRP.
Is there a possibility that Ripple could take over Swift one day?
Well, welcome back, Lee Jones. So, to our script, let's get right into today's video. We are going to see an XRP ETF in 2024 or 2025, 100%. Brad Garlinghouse was just asked an hour ago if they would welcome an XRP ETF, and take a listen to what he said here.
So you would welcome an XRP ETF then?
We would certainly welcome it, and I think it's inevitable that there'll be, you know, multiple ETFs around different tokens. And I think you'll even see ETFs potentially around baskets that also, I think, further diversify that risk.
Given there's so much excitement around the ETF dynamic here, are you in talks with the largest issuers, particularly BlackRock, to get this done?
Well, I'm not going to comment on that. I know BlackRock has said some things publicly.
Will you do another ETF? How about an XRP ETF? I know you got the ether out there. How about XRP? Can you answer that?
I can't. And you don't want me to.
I do.
Well, I can't.
All right. They're giving me the rap. Thank you.
You know, we think it makes sense for the XRP community overall. You know, Ripple obviously is a very important stakeholder in the XRP ecosystem, but we're not the only player. And like we've seen, I mean, before the SEC lawsuit, XRP was the second most valuable digital asset. I think because of the headwinds of that lawsuit, you know, we've now seen that largely abate. But the long-term view on these things is about, you know, how do you create utility and really solve real-world problems with these different digital assets? Bitcoin's doing that very well as a store of value. XRP and its dynamics around being very fast, very efficient, and low cost on a per transaction basis makes it ideal for payments. And that's where Ripple really has leaned into as a company. I'm not going to put a horizon on the time, but I think there will be other ETFs for sure.
An XRP one?
There will be other ETFs for sure.
but an XRP one?
I love this game we play.
Here, are you in talks with the largest issuers, particularly BlackRock, to get this done?
Well, I'm not going to comment on that. I know BlackRock has said some things publicly.
You cannot argue the facts whether an XRP ETF will happen or not. It is going to happen. We have Larry being asked about it. Larry knows about it. BlackRock is aware about it. Everybody is buzzing around an XRP ETF. It's not a matter of if it's going to happen. It's just about when. And within the next 2 years, in my opinion, it is going to happen 100%. Welcome back to another episode. Swift is deeply working with Ripple, and soon everything will be made public. I'm going to break that down to you in a moment. But do you guys remember this man right here? Yes, this man is Sam Bankman-Fried. He was one of the richest men on the planet. And now here we have a prison picture from him that was just released yesterday. Take a look at him. Wow, that's all I got to say. And here we have him updated on the Forbes rich list, real-time net worth as zero. But now let's get into Swift, Ripple, and them verbally just saying they're working with Ripple. Four innovations shaping the future of finance. A key focus for us is helping to ensure global interoperability between the new digital currencies and existing payment systems. How many times have we heard that? How many times have we heard that? And no doubt, this will be a complex challenge given the plethora of technologies, standards, and protocols being used to develop them. And take a listen to this quote by Pallavi. We are working closely with our community to ensure we can support new forms of value on our network to enable instant and frictionless value transfer in the digital paradigm. Are you kidding me? I mean, Pallavi's background prior to Swift, I mean, you guys want to take a quick guess? It was R3 for 2 years and 3 months. And they further went on to say, we are currently conducting a second phase of sandbox trials of our Swift connector solution with over 30 central and commercial banks, testing new use cases such as delivery versus payment in security transactions, trade-based trigger payments, and on-chain FX trade and settlement. You can't stay silent about this anymore. And here we have Kalani. She's the head of payments at Swift, saying they're working with Citibank and Ripple in terms of tokenization and CBDCs.
So we really try to keep, up to date what's happening in the market to make sure that, you know, whether we are participating and supporting different initiatives where possible, we do our own experimentations. You're absolutely right, right? So we talked with Pega and with Ryan on tokenized assets and CBDCs and doing a lot of experimentation in both kind of areas as the market, you know, has identified those as key next steps of what the next way into interoperability. And so if you look at tokenization, you know, we started off last year looking at how we can be the single point person hooking up tokenized platforms to different payment platforms. And now we're working with a group of banks who are actually doing some experiments to see if they can use their existing SWIFT infrastructure to instruct the value of tokenized assets across multiple private and public blockchains. CBDCs, we've been working in for a little bit longer. We started off creating a connector on the CBDC side, you know, between DLT-based and fiat-based systems using existing financial rails. Then we did some sandboxing again with a small group of people just to see, does this make sense? Is this the right way? And, feedback from that group was, yes, it makes sense, and let's continue on experimenting. Then we had some central banks actually say, let me take your CBDC connector and we'll put it into our infrastructure and start doing some testing. And then we just opened up a second phase of sandbox testing with a larger group of banks and central and commercial banks that are looking at different use cases now and around FX and liquidity.
And a clip by Brooks at Whistle. He's been working at Ripple for 3 years, and previously he was at Uber for 3 years and Goldman Sachs for 18 years. And he pretty much says, I mean, there's no doubt they're going away from SWIFT, but they're gonna complement each other. But Ripple is gonna have a major role within this next infrastructure.
Point is really interesting because one of the things, and I'm sure Brian's noticed from his time from being the regulator to now, we've noticed this even the last year, a lot of the banks, basically all the banks that you would go to 5 years ago with a solution that said, hey, you know what, that SWIFT thing, why don't you put that to the side and we can give you a replacement network to send money overseas between banks. No one wanted to even have you in the room. But these banks are all moving very quickly with their own, you know, desks being set up. Their high net worth clients are asking for it now. And so they will evolve in the same way that others will have to come along. And if they don't, and if they're sitting still and not asking questions or haven't identified a smart young person to be driving this for them right now, that's a bad place to be.
SWIFT and large financial institutions cannot run away from this technology. They're going to have to come work together and adopt it. It's going to get regulated. It's going to take over. They're going to lose revenue, but they're going to make more revenue in the future from holding digital assets. So in the long run, it will benefit them. It's just about having the right transition. Remember, we're connecting 200 economies together, trying to create a level playing field. And I mean, it's crazy that we get to live through this as we watch it live. With that being said, we'll be back with another video.
We started building RippleNet with the thesis that crypto liquidity would eventually be able to support robust global payments, large payments. RippleNet was designed so that customers seeing the benefits of our fiat-based network could flip the switch to ODL once the market was mature enough. And this is exactly what's happening.
Flip the switch.
I think what we're building has, you know, it's solving a real problem. And I think all of the tokens, my advice to anybody would be, understand the utility. If there's real utility and there's real value being delivered to a real customer, there will be value in the token.